Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear brothers and my sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. I received a question from a sister, and the summary of the question is about, does loving Allah mean continuous tests and hardships? In other words, she is asking, when I am pious and close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is it all right? I mean, is that the norm that I am being hammered day in, day out by continuous problems and so that I remain patient to increase my rewards and everything? What if I really don't want to be hammered? I don't want these problems. I just want to be close to Allah and lead a normal life. Sometimes, my dear brothers and my sisters, a question cannot be answered by a simple yes or no, or by a simple sentence or advice, but rather by going deeper, deep far beyond the motives of that question. Because certain questions just speak volumes about many things, many understandings and philosophies. If this person here had been properly educated, she would never have said these things. But some people these days, subhanAllah, especially Muslims, everything to them is sad. We have become like the Jewish people. The religion of Moses has rubbed into us. The children of Israel today, they believe that the Jews, are under the continuous wrath of Allah, which is true, because Allah says that in the Quran, and they know this. Also, as Muslims today, we keep thinking that Allah is angry with us. No matter how much we do, we're doomed. Allah is just around the corner waiting for us for the next problem, for the next mistake. And if we are not making any mistakes, He still is waiting. He's sending us baits after baits after baits. When are we going to take the bait and make mistakes? And then we are cursed for eternity. SubhanAllah al-Haq, this breaks my heart because al-Islam never came for such philosophies. This is people scaring the regular Muslim, that is you and I. They're making us pee our pants, that if we do anything, we are doomed. The question of the sister gets something along those lines. My relationship with Allah is most important to me, and I know that tests will draw me closer to Allah, to cry, to beg, and realize that I only rely on Him. But I feel I don't want my closeness to Allah to be through constant calamities. I want to feel constant blessings and gratitude and thankfulness. I have to keep reminding myself through my constant low and sadness that I have beautiful kids, a roof over my head, food to give my family, and no disability. I then feel so much gratitude and say others are worse than me. I just feel I have so many tests and they don't seem to end. They are not small ones, but big ones that I feel I can win them. Example, my marriage problems. And no matter how close these problems bring me closer to Allah, and no matter how much dua and prayers I make or charity I give, or how much extra salat I make, or how much, my situation does not change and my tests get worse. What am I doing wrong? What do I need to change? Can I not be more closer to Allah through gratitude rather than calamity? Wallahi, this is a very heartfelt question asked by a very intelligent and honest lady. On behalf of hundreds of millions of male and female Muslims throughout the world, especially in a religious culture imposed by man-made laws, and rules in which no one can ask questions. You cannot ask questions because the moment you open your mouth to ask a question, you put in right back to where you belong and they tell you, who are you to question Allah? We're not questioning Allah. We are just trying to understand what is happening to us. Is it because of our deeds or is it because of something else? So, is it true, my dear brothers and my sisters, that being close to Allah only means more tests, problems, and hardships? Does this mean that being far from Allah means less tests, problems, and hardship? In retrospect, does this scaringly mean that being closer to a shaitan would then mean no tests, no problems, and no hardships? So is this how the cookies crumble in Islam? Before I go any further to answer this question, I'd like to say this. That we as humans, and I mean humans, including the Japanese, the Australian, the American, Canadian, African, any human, has been gifted with an ultimate, endless number of tools to succeed in this life. And the beautiful saying of the sky is the limit applies to everything in our lives, regardless of how close or how far we are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let me start by first thing first. Where is the problem of us understanding that getting closer to Allah will yield us calamities, but being far from Allah will not? The culprit is a hadith in Sunan Ibn Majah and At-Tirmidhi. This hadith is Sa'd ibn Abi al-Waqqas radiallahu anhu. Qal, he said, قلت يا رسول الله, I said, Messenger of Allah, أي الناس أشد بلاء, who of the people have hard tests? Qal, he said, answered صلى الله عليه وسلم, الأنبياء, the prophets. ثم الأمثل فالأمثل, then the likes and the likes. فيبتلى الرجل على حسب دينه. فإن كان دينه صلبا اشتد بلاؤه. A man would be tested based on their religion. I hear the man and woman. We will be tested based on our religion. If the religion is strong and powerful, the tests will be strong and powerful. وإن كان في دينه رقة, and if in his deen, in his religion, the way he practices, the way she practices, is a not a very powerful, there is a weakness. There is softness. ابتلي على حسب دينه. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests him on the strength of his or weakness of his religion. فما يبرح البلاء بالعبد حتى يتركه يمشي على الأرض ما عليه خطيئة. And these tests will not leave the man or the woman on this earth because of the hardships they cause and the problems. They will clean and wipe out every sin we committed. As I said, this hadith is reported by Ibn Majah and At-Tirmidhi and authenticated by Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani. If you remember, I mentioned before that the books of hadith are classified based on their authenticity and the strength of their hadith. And I said before that an authentic hadith, hadith sahih in al-Bukhari, is much stronger than that in Muslim, is much stronger in that of the one that follows it, Abu Dawood, and then An-Nasa'i, then Ibn Majah, and At-Tirmidhi at the end. So here, as you can see, the authenticity then of those ahadith that is in Ibn Majah and At-Tirmidhi. At-Tirmidhi is number 5, Ibn Majah is number 6. The strength of this ahadith, the two of them, is not that very strong. This is why Al-Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, and An-Nasa'i have completely rejected the addition of this hadith. They did not qualify it as strong enough to be part of their books. In other terms, this hadith did not fulfill the criteria of strong authenticity for Al-Bukhari and the rest of them. So it's reported in At-Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah. The authentication of Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani, as I said before, Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah, his powers in hadith depend on what he does. If he weakens a hadith, he is an authority in that. That his authentication is not always as authentic. This is why before his death alayhi rahmatullah, he went back on 500 hadith that he qualified as authentic, and then he changed his mind and classified them as weak ones. The other issue with this hadith is that it doesn't work hand in hand with the Quran. And as I said before, when the Quran says something and the hadith says something, the hadith must be disregarded for the Quran. Unlike some people, they will tell you that the hadith would abrogate the Quran, and this is an absolute nonsense. The Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is 100% authentic and 100% the words that Allah revealed, but the hadith is not, as I said before, the hadith is only reported by the meaning. So here, Islam really say that the closer we get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more troubles we get? Well, the problem with this understanding is that people have localized al-Islam. They made al-Islam for the people that are already Muslims, but al-Quran doesn't take that path all the way. Islam is a universal religion, and so are its teachings. Any ayah in the Quran must be understood as a universal law, or else a teaching for mankind as a whole, ya ayyuhan nas, unless specifically mentioned that it is not. And this is usually preceded by ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, or you that have believed. When Allah says you that have believed, He speaks specifically to the Muslims, to us today, those who have believed in the Prophet Muhammad and are following him. Otherwise, when Allah speaks, He is talking to mankind as a whole. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has explicitly pointed this reality out in His Quran. Many ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has emphasized the wisdom that the Prophet Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is sent to the entire of mankind. Entire mankind means the Chinese, Japanese, Swedish, Danish, Finnish, American, Canadian, Mexicans, and you go around the world, all of them, when the Quran is read, they are spoken to through it. Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَّةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا. And we have not sent you, and speaks about Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, except to all mankind as a bringer of good news and tidings and a warner. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. But most of the people do not know this. And the reason why they don't know this is because we Muslims, instead of making Islam a universal religion, we made it a local religion. It has become like wudu, salat, this thing here. It's like Allah speaks only to us, when in fact, Allah is talking to the entire mankind. As Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَّةً لِلنَّاسِ. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, therefore, when he speaks, he doesn't speak to the people of Al-Madinah al-Quraysh, he speaks to everybody around the universe. So, in another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala further goes on saying, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And we have not sent you except as a mercy to mankind. So, if this mercy of Allah, when people are close to Him, He punishes them, He sends them tough tests, and He sends them hardship after hardship, how is His punishment? So why does Allah want to do this? Some people lie when they speak about these kind of things. It makes me want to bang my head against the wall, because they say Allah tests you for patience. Hang on here. Why would Allah want to test me for patience? I'm pious. I'm not doing major sins. I'm doing my very best to be as close as possible to Him. Why would He want to do that to me? Why would He push me to my limits? Why? What's in that for me? Subhanallah. And yet they tell you, because He wants you to sin, and then He will erase this. Wallahi, sometimes they speak nonsense in the name of Islam. Allah is not some kind of somebody out there who will set traps after traps after traps after traps, continuous traps, that you keep jumping through them until you fall flat on your face, then you get punished hard. That is not Allah. That is not Allah. In every ayah, you can precede it with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Every ayah in Al-Quran except Surah At-Tawbah. But every other part of Al-Quran, if you start reciting Al-Quran from anywhere, you can just say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim in the name of Allah, the Rahman, the Rahim. And don't make the mistake of translating this, as many people would say, in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. Don't translate that, and go on my YouTube channel. You will find a khutbah about the danger of translation. So, again, let me go back here to the reality that Allah has put in the Quran that applies to every single human out there. Reality number one, that is tests on earth, is of two folds: good tests bad test. By that I mean, Allah can give you tons of money as a test. Gives you palaces, plenty cars, plenty workers, tons of businesses, everything that you can dream of, and they are a test. On the other hand, He can give you absolutely nothing, and that is a test. A third option, He can give you some here and some there, but you don't get it straight all the way through. Sometimes you have everything that's working fine for you, and then one child, just one child, doesn't come the way you would want them to, and then all your life becomes misery and hellish. Certain issues, you understand that they happen for a reason. And that reason is not necessarily that Allah sets trap for you, but because this is dunya, this is life. If life was completely troubleless, what's the difference between it and Jannah? Allah wanted Al-Jannah to be the ultimate place of no problems, no tests whatsoever. And He so wanted as well hellfire to be the place of full problems, full punishment, full traps, full of everything. Allah says in the Quran, فَأَمَّا الْإِنسَانُ إِذَا مَبْتَلَاهُ رَبُّهُ فَأَكْرَمَهُ وَنَعَمَهُ فَيَقُولُ رَبِّ أَكْرَمًا. Yet as man, when and if his Lord puts him through tests, good tests, by honoring him or her and giving them loads, they will say, my Lord has honored me. This is also mentioned in Surah Al-Kahf, the man who Allah has given businesses and tons of money and everything. And this is mankind's thought. If I have money, if my kids are well behaved, if everything is going accordingly and properly and beautifully, then that means I am good terms with Allah. And this is a major error that we make. What you have in dunya does not speak, is not a bespeaking matter on how you rank with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, rock and roll singers, drug, music, and rock and roll, and all these things, tons of money. Sometimes you hear people worth in the market is phenomenal. I am personally, me Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa, probably in the market, I'm not even worth £100. Yet, you will find somebody else who is worth £600 million or dollars. The other one is $3 billion. The other one is $900 billion, some phenomenal matters out there. You scratch your head. Huh, how did they get all that money? You take people that have lived exactly the same amount as you, yet their worth, net worth in the market is 600 million or the 300 million or whatever. Where did they get all that money? And when you look back, they didn't steal. Something somewhere has worked for them. That is a test by Allah. And He sees how this person behaves. And on the other side of the coin, وَأَمَّا إِذَا مَبْتَلَاهُ فَقَدَرَ عَلَيْهِ رِزْقًا. Yet when He tests him and restricts his provision for him or for her, then mankind straightway will say, if Allah loved me, He would not have humiliated me. Why? Why am I not loved by Allah? But then again, this is another mistake. Allah doesn't take from you because He hates you. At the end of the day, let me ask you this question. Why what's happening to you now? Why do you think it is a test from Allah? I have worked with people at life coaching. They say, or I always tell them, don't put yourself under a very heavy, bad, dirty water tap and say, this is my destiny. Don't throw yourself in a dumpyard. Don't go and sleep there and then say, this is my test in this dunya. There is project management. There is everything that you can do to change your life. There is self-help books. Look at your current situation. The person here mentions her marriage. Everything, and if, absolutely you had no say in this marriage, I would understand that you are trapped. But you have the freedom to do what you want. If you're not happy in this marriage, break away. That's why Islam gave you al-khula, the withdrawal from the marriage, and you only need one menses after that, and you're free. Why? What? if someone is totally broke, I see a lot of people break and they ask with mesquinery and they go, this is Qadarullah. I tell them, you lie, this is not Qadarullah. How do you know that Allah has written on you poverty? Have you worked? Have you done everything that you need to do? We say time has no barakah in it. I say, you lie. Because the people out there who Allah has spoken to, and these are people, the Japanese, go to a Japanese and tell him the time has no barakah. He will take you and put you in a zoo and he will say, here is a man that really thinks like a monkey. No, my dear brothers and my sisters, what's happening to you is a choice by your own hands. Don't keep driving in a banger of a car that breaks often and say, this is Qadarullah. Get rid of the car, work harder and get a better car. If something is not working for you in your life, look at it, think of it, study on how to make it better and move on. We all have our share of the tests. But don't you ever think that getting closer to Allah will yield you trouble. Anyone who preaches such is absolutely wrong. And even say, for argument's sake, we're going to accept that the hadith, okay, the toughest that get it hard are the prophets. But Allah doesn't speak here about their food and the job. He speaks here about what they do with people when they promote Islam. So as you work with people, they're going to accuse you of a liar, of a sorcery, of someone who wants to use religion to your end, and. Yes, but it's not like you don't have to eat today and your kids don't listen to you and you have the phone bills and you have the telephone bills and your husband is not good to you. These have absolutely nothing to do with the love of Allah. The husband you're married to, you chose it. The wife you're married to, you chose it. This is why there are laws in Islam to regulate our marital life. The job that you got, you chose it. You can break away from it. Don't let yourself in the middle, in the eye of the hurricane, and then blame Allah is because I'm close to Allah. Don't be just like that preacher who took the Bible and he went to a lion cage and he said, I believe in Jesus Christ, and by jumping in with the Bible, the lion will not eat me. Do you know what the lion did after him? He ate him. Because a lion has been created to eat. Don't accuse Allah of our own miseries. If I am unemployed, I must not accuse Allah for making me unemployed. I must accuse myself. The tests of Allah are not for the believers. Allah doesn't want anything by making you poor, broke, and totally out of it. That's not Allah. So, does loving Allah yield us more troubles? No, it does not. No, it does not. And when a problem happens, if you can change it, change it. And as you change it, you are patient, you get great rewards, great things. But if you are just going to sit outside under the rain and the cold torrent of waters and then say, it's because I'm closer to Allah, that's why I am in the rain, I would say, I am sorry, you've got the elephant by the tail when you thought you had it by the trunk. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this opens your eyes, and always, 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 if your life is not going the way you want it to go, it's because the thoughts, the plans, the goals that you have set yourself have led you there. Allah will help you in this dunya attain the goals that you want. Allah has made all the rules working for you. Look at it. A field next to your door. You can plant in it tomatoes and you can plant on it potatoes and you will get those vegetables. And you can plant in it marijuana and drugs and the earth will give you. That because Allah has commanded earth to obey you. So my dear brothers and my sisters, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not get you troubles. It's our thinking. Get off where you are seated now and use what you get. And pretty soon, you'll be very, very far. If you don't know how to, I am a life coach. I've helped tons of people to get to their lives. I can give you a session or two for free to help you see clear where you're headed. And you will see. You'll start changing your direction and life will be better for you. Don't be all those people who have problems with their husbands or spouses. But they don't want to change, but they want the problem to go. I'm sorry, Allah will not work miracles for you. You gotta do them for yourself. If you need any help, please get in touch with me. This is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. And if you want to join my WhatsApp group, please do send me a message on 078-76-40-8735. I am in England, so add 0044. وصلي اللهم على نبينا محمد سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك and I pray to Allah to make our lives bearable until we meet him and he is happy with us. آمين 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 والسلام عليكم.